Is anyone in here a Cardinals fan? I made that assumption at 8 a.m. and there was not any. And so I just wanted to check before I made that assumption because it, you know what they say about assumptions. So here's the question. If I wanted to become a Cardinals fan, like I grew up watching the Bears lose. I was in the 90s, and I grew up greatly appreciating watching Bears snatch defeat from the jaws of victory on a regular basis. And so I don't appreciate baseball. If I wanted to become a Cardinals fan, what terms would I need to understand? Are there statistics I would need to understand? Well, let's start with the basics. When does the baseball season begin? That's not a rhetorical question. I actually don't know. When does baseball begin?
April 1st.
Okay. All right. Well, think about that. What's that?
Spring training.
Spring training? Like, okay, I guess that would be in spring. But are there statistics? I hear there's a lot of, like, the fact that if you're talking about in a field and you're talking about it in a very intensely focused fashion, like, what do they call it? Insider baseball, right? If you're talking, like, it strikes me that if I was going to appreciate baseball, there's a whole terminology and set of statistics that I would need to understand. And how do you go about learning this? Yeah, got to be involved, probably with someone else, right? Any group that gathers around a shared activity over time develops a common calendar, task, terminology, way of speaking about things. I had my brakes worked on while I was in Illinois, and the guy who did the work explained to me what he had done, and I know that he was speaking English. There were a few words in there that it's just terminology, right? To anyone else who's a mechanic, it made completely coherent sense. To me, here's my $300, thank you. It was, and it's mechanics, it's education, and there's lingo in education. Farming, if construction, sales, management, if you think of banking, if you think of any field, there is always a terminology, a lingo, a way of talking about things that if someone walked in who wasn't familiar, they would have that same response. You're speaking English, but I'm not sure what you're saying. And that is also true of church. Like, there are terms that we say in church that we don't say anywhere else. There's a whole, if you look up the term Christianese, you can find whole lists of these. But a few examples, like benediction, doxology, liturgy, narthex. I mean, we look up, there's these words, and we don't hear them anywhere else in our lives. And so what do we do about that? Like, there are some churches I know who do everything they can to get rid of all of the Christian words, all the Christianese. They want to get rid of all the words so there's no lingo, and you walk in and everyone's going to talk just normal. And that's one extreme. The other extreme is to embrace all of these words that we have inherited and use them as often as possible. I have been in a church that had on a sign, it pointed to church office, and then it pointed to the nave. That's an old church word. You know what a nave, anyone here know what a nave is? Yeah, excellent, I didn't. I have a degree in this, and I had no clue that we're sitting in a nave. Like, this is the nave right here. I had no clue. So how do we handle this? I think that we have to be practical about it. Well, there are words that we could never use again. If I never said the word nave ever again, I can faithfully follow Jesus, right? If you never hear the word nave, I mean, that, whatever, not a problem. But there are words that we need to hold on to just for the practicality. Like, if you're a mechanic and you need to get a long cylindrical object that creates spark on a regular basis to ignite a mixture of oxygen and gas, you could say that every time, or what could you say instead? Spark plug, right? Like, we can, that's what we're going to look at. What are some of the words that we need to be able to use and use well simply for the matter of practicality? Like, if I'm going to live the rest of my life following Jesus, I can never say knave again, but I have to say grace. Right? There are words I have to be able to say and to use well and be able to explain well. And so we're going to look at some words, some Christianese over the next couple weeks. Grace, repentance, blessed. Like, we say something is a blessing. What exactly does that mean? Say something is a blessing. Well, blessing, salvation, predestination. And next week, I'm going to have a cheat sheet of Christianese. And I've been kind of gathering some of the words. And you have a piece of paper that I'm going to invite you when it gets to the offering. If you have a word that you want to have defined, just write that word down, fold it over, put it in the offering plate, and I will add it to the list, and I will attempt to define it for next time. I probably will have to look some of them up. But or email me whatever comes to mind. So grace, that's the word we're looking at today. When it comes to understanding words that the church uses, our best friend is Paul. Because if you think of who Paul was, Paul was the guy who originally didn't follow Jesus, was persecuting followers of Jesus, had arrest warrants to go take care of followers of Jesus, and then Jesus had a discussion with him. Paul, why are you persecuting me? And Paul says, oh, I'd like to do that differently now. And so then after that, he goes out and he is beginning churches. And he has to explain to people what it means to follow Jesus. Well, so he has to explain these words and how they are used and what they mean. And so we have these letters of Paul explaining to people what are these words, how do they explain, what are they getting at? And so one of the times he talks about grace is in his letter to the church at Corinth. And this is a letter to the church at Corinth when the church at Corinth is acting like a teenager. It's a church that's looking at Paul and saying, but why do I have to do what you say? If you ever have a teenager look up at you and say, but I don't have to. Well, why do I have to follow you? Why do I have to do what my parents say? Like, I have at least 5 years before I get that. It's coming, I know. But that's what Corinth is doing. And Paul is responding and saying, well, let me tell you about who I am and why you're doing what I suggest to you. And he says, you know what? You don't listen to me because I'm somehow perfect or have it all figured out. Because let me remind you, I have a problem. What Paul reminds them is, I have a thorn in my side. I have something that has humbled me and made my life hard for years. And they knew it because he was with them for years, and they had seen how hard of a time Paul had. And we're not certain when Paul says he had a thorn in his side, we're not certain what that is. He never explicitly says. The best evidence is that it was a problem with his vision. Because if you read the letters of Paul, he often dictates them, and then when he signs them at the end, at least on one occasion he writes, look at this, my handwriting, the writing of Paul, look how big my letters are. Which sounds like someone who has to get right up to the page and write really big so he can see. And if you think, so we're going to work with that assumption that Paul has a vision problem, and we're long before the days of eyeglasses where that could be corrected. And so if you think about Paul is traveling, and he's meeting a lot of new people. And if there's one thing you'd want to be able to do if you're traveling a lot, meeting a lot of new people, it'd be able to see them, right? Because you'd be able to recognize when they walk in the door, because we remember faces, but we don't remember names, right? So this would be a very useful thing for him to be able to do, to see. And he reminds them, the church at Corinth, that this is a problem he has had, and he has cried out 3 times to God to heal this. Remember, what are the stories that Paul has told them? He has told them the stories of Jesus. And Jesus heals on a regular basis. Like, Jesus rolls into town, heals some people, teaches a bit, shares a meal. That's his MO. That's what he does. Roll into town, heal, teach, and then have a meal. And so, yes, Paul, I'm sure, has prayed more than 3 times, God, you healed all those other people. Could you take care of this? Right here, paying attention. I can't see you, but I know you see me, right? And what he realized, and what he says to the church at Corinth, is that God's grace is sufficient, that God's power is made more obvious and is fulfilled, is made complete and worked out in Paul, if Paul is not some sort of perfect specimen of humanity. Right? If Paul rolls into town, tells everyone the story of Jesus and the good news of Jesus Christ and how he is there to help people who are in need, and he is like a model of physical perfection, that's a little bit harder to believe than if Paul kind of stumbles into town and says, God's grace can get me through. Look how much I struggle. God's grace can get you through too. Make sense? Right? So when Paul starts talking about grace, Paul is talking about grace as something very practical. Grace is what gets him through when he's really struggling, and he's always struggling because he can't see very well. It's a challenge for him. But God's grace is sufficient. He realizes this. And it makes it a lot easier for other people to see him and realize it as well. This is what then informs, years later, Paul writes a letter to the church at Rome. And it's a kind of a poignant letter, because it's a letter written by someone who realizes he's not going to get everywhere he wants to. You hit a certain point in your life and you realize you're not going to be able to travel to all the places you've always wanted to travel. That's where Paul's at when he's writing the letter to Rome. He's writing, you know, I've been trying to get to you, I've been trying, and I just can't seem to get over that way. And he writes the letter because he may not get there, but his letter can. And so he writes the letter, and he's explaining to people whom he's never met. Like, the church at Corinth, they know him well. These people do not. And so he's trying to help them understand what it means to follow Jesus so that they do not go astray. And so he points out to them that they are given Torah, the teachings of God, so that they might see clearly how they have fallen, because it's a very human inclination to downplay our own problems. Like, you do something really stupid, and then you say, oh, it really wasn't that bad. No, it really was. You're just trying to be nice to yourself. No, Torah is to help us see, no, it really is that bad. And even as it is that bad, here is the good news. The good news is that Jesus, while we were yet sinners, died for us so that we might follow him through this life and into the life to come. And he says that this grace is more powerful than sin. That this grace, what Jesus has done, is far greater than any other problem we will ever face. And so if we look at how Paul uses the word grace, we can start to see that grace is not like an individual event. It's a really big word. It's a big concept. It's a big thing to get our minds around. Grace is a stance that God has towards us of aggressively seeking us out to embrace and to lead us to life that God has planned for us. Grace is this free gift of what God does, giving us what we need when we need it. Right? So grace is a far bigger thing than any one moment. Grace is an approach that God takes towards us. It is the grace that we see Paul having experienced. When Paul was far from Christ, Jesus reaches out to him and says, hey, why are you persecuting me? God is seeking him out. And then God is with him when he is struggling and when he is struggling with his vision and there to sustain him. And God takes him through all of his years until he is able to say, again in Romans, to die, to live is Christ, to live is to be like Christ. To live is Christ and to die is gain. Right, to be able to say that's quite a statement of faith. So we can see how that works in our lives as well. Grace is how God stands towards us, so that God is seeking us when we were far from him. I can see the grace in my life that when I was far from God, God was seeking me such that that Wesley House up at Truman found me and showed me grace and showed me beauty and showed me community and said, here you are. Here is what you need, Andy. That's grace. That's God reaching out towards me. Grace is that feeling of And grace can be in this experience of music and in beauty, that whatever draws people towards the church. And grace is then the experience of being forgiven and knowing that Christ died for us. Grace is that experience of peace and joy and the rush of assurance and knowing that God is for us and not against us. And then grace is what continues throughout our lives when we know that there is no problem we can face that God has not already conquered and that we are heading towards God's kingdom. Right? So grace is this lifelong experience, grace after grace after grace, heading towards a kingdom that will never disappoint as it is Jesus's kingdom. I cannot follow Jesus without using the word grace, because grace names the very nature of how God relates to us. It's a word that is so big that it encompasses God seeking, God embracing, and God transforming us into his likeness. And so I think it's a word we need to be able to use so that we can help people understand and understand ourselves the nature of being a Christian. Deciding to follow Jesus is one of the most important decisions we can make. I would dare say it is more important than even deciding to appreciate Cardinals baseball. And to be able to talk about it, we need to be able to talk about it well. And that means we need to be able to talk about grace. God reaching for, embracing, and leading us towards him. Amen.